Good afternoon, sir. Welcome back to Madras after what I suppose to be a very rewarding tour of the United States and Japan. During the last few weeks, you have seen the greater part of the United States and spent some time in Japan. Could you kindly tell us what impressed you most in the States?
Well, naturally, my tour of the United States and Japan has given me much food for thought. Any developing country should learn certain lessons from advanced countries like America and Japan to study the pattern of their development, how they have reconstructed their economy, and how they are progressing so fast in all walks of life. So I was naturally interested in getting a first-hand study of all these things. The tour was very impressive. I have had occasion to see many states in the United States, beginning from New York to San Francisco. Agricultural bases, industrial plants, and all the items that go to make up a country progressive, I have had occasions to study. I also had close discussions, intimate discussions, with economists, professors in various universities, students of America and students from our own country. And I was very greatly benefited by the thought that they have created by their discussions with me.
What is the dominant American reaction to our planning and economic development?
Well, the American people and the American government, they are very much interested in the success of our plan. They think that only through planning we can reconstruct our economy. And they are happy that we have had three plans and we are on the threshold of the fourth plan. But they feel that we could have done better. The colossal sum spent on planning, the care that was taken by the planners about projects, all these things they appreciate. But in the matter of implementation of these plans, they feel that we have not got adequate returns. Especially, they are very unhappy over the performance of our public sector undertakings.
You are mentioning about some Asian studies, particularly Indian studies, undertaken in the Yale and Kansas universities by the professors and students there. Could you kindly tell us what is the specific problem or problems relating to India that they were most interested in?
And the fourth plan is still in the offing. I told them that unless massive aid comes from advanced countries, especially from America, we cannot fulfill the target of the fourth plan, because the fourth plan will have naturally to be bigger than the third plan. Because first, we have to carry on what we have begun in the third plan and add something more. They appreciate our difficulties, but they also feel that the aid is not the sole monopoly of America alone, and other countries also should come. I told them that if America shows the way, other countries will follow, and that argument was well appreciated.
You are mentioning also about some population studies that these students and the professors are making there, with reference to India. Could you kindly just enlighten us on that?
Yes, also. I told them actually we have lost certain parliament seats because our population has been reduced. They were very happy to hear that. But they think that there are certain other states in India which are backward in thought and which have not taken very kindly to family planning. Next to family planning, they are very much anxious that the political stability of India should be assured. Having read about various governments being formed and then disbanded, people crossing floor, political debacle and other things, they think that the future is a little bit shaky. But I assured them that we have conducted three general elections in a comparatively calm manner. And whatever may be the struggles and riots here and there, the casualty in all these four general elections is lesser than the American casualty during holidays. They appreciated that argument very much and said that our country has built up a good democratic tradition, but now they feel that the central government is not as strong as it was before, and they were asking me whether it will last long. I told them there is no immediate possibility or apprehension of the present central government being replaced by some other government. In some place they asked me if there is an invitation for the formation of a national coalition government in the center, what would you do? I told them that I would resist the temptation.
We read in the papers about your meeting with the Indian students in Japan, and you are urging them to emulate the Japanese devotion to work. Would you kindly elaborate this a little further? I mean the Japanese industriousness and their will to succeed.
Yes, the Japanese, and then I asked students from India studying in Japan to emulate the example of every Japanese, because every Japanese, whatever may be their controversy over ideologies and political systems, every Japanese feels that he should rise to the top. He should give his full devotion to work so that he can make his country rich compared with other advanced countries. And their patriotic impulse is confined not in singing national anthems or in parades or in flag hoisting, but work, work and work alone. And I asked our students to emulate that example and come and impart that to our people. They then said that you have got very great influence with our people, you can tell that to them. I replied, after all, fortunately or unfortunately, I happen to be a politician. A politician's word will not be taken with the full sense. They may think there is some propaganda behind it. But if you students who have been to Japan for so many years, if you return to our country and tell our people how the Japanese people are progressing, then it would have good effect. And most of the students agreed and consented when they come to India to impart that message to our people.
From the extensive tour, do you think there are any lessons or experiences which our country should study with reference to our economic development?
So one thing that I have learned there is that the industrial prosperity of most of the countries is based upon the agricultural prosperity of that country. Unless the agricultural base is strong, unless our rural part becomes rich, then there cannot be an industrial superimposition. I feel, and I have told that also, that in the first two plans, we did not give as much of emphasis and importance to agriculture as we ought to have given. And most of the countries, including America, they first developed their agriculture. And through agriculture, they raised the prosperity of rural parts. And when there is prosperity in the rural parts, they were able to contribute, share amount, or even capital for various industries that were started. That was how the industrial progress of America was established. That is a lesson that we should learn. In our country, we should also learn another thing, and I told that to American audiences also. In America, most of the industries are capital oriented. Because there is a shortage of manpower, they want everything to be done on a massive scale through machines, and they do not utilize more men there. But in our country, the manpower is so large that our industries or our projects ought to be more labor oriented than capital oriented. As a matter of fact, I think that Japan offers us more on agricultural front than even America, because in Japan there is no large scale farming. 3 acres, 4 acres, 5 acres. I even went in a train from Tokyo to Kyoto, a distance of about 300 miles. All through there were paddy fields and villages. In all the paddy fields, I found Japanese farmers using this power tiller. I did not meet with any bullock-drawn plow at all. And if we develop our agriculture on that line, we can make our educated young men take to agriculture. Because now if you ask our educated young men to go to the field and plow, they feel somewhat diffident to take to this bullock plowing. But if they are offered this power tiller and if they are told that agriculture has been mechanized, more people will get interest in agriculture. And I told the American audience also that as far as agriculture is concerned, Japan is to be our model for a long number of years to come. But of course, when we get many industrial potentiality and we have got alternative employment for our people, and when we progressively reduce the percentage of people dependent on agriculture, then we can mechanize. Which means, I am not against mechanization or mass production, but I am fully conscious of the manpower that is to be found in our country. Therefore, we should progress keeping in mind the basic fact that many projects in our country for a long number of years to come is to be labor-oriented.
Thank you.
It is perhaps an irony of fate and certainly the most shocking of events that the one country that has been propagating continuously, consistently and most sincerely the ideals of peace and brotherhood, goodwill and coexistence, always pleading for the enthronement of reason and justice, ever ready to offer the helping hand to ease out difficulties, that India should have become the victim of a calculated and naked aggression from a brutal power, China, which has been loudly expressing friendly, nay brotherly affection towards India all these years. It is this shock more than the might of the armed forces of China that was responsible for the initial reverses on the battlefield. Today, they, not we, are marching backwards. China has understood, to some extent at any rate, that India will not be cowed down, but will retaliate and fight till victory is assured and justice is triumphant. A peace-loving country does not mean a land of cowards. Many are the battles won and laurels gathered by our ancients, and inspiring are the ballads sung by the bards of bygone times. Heroism is not a thing of the past. It is still here and in abundance. We are busy mobilizing valor and striking power. Our warriors have already won renown on the battlefield, and the heroism shown by them has evoked the esteem of all right-minded persons. This is no idle boast or mere patriotic fervor, but an acknowledged fact. Acknowledged by the experts in the military field. The military members of the Harriman mission saw the battlefront and were much impressed with the bravery of our troops. The stoutness of heart and valor of our men can be best understood only when we realize the nature of the terrain and the treacherous tactics adopted by the aggressors. The path through which the troops have to march is so perilous, the winter wind so biting, that none but the most daring could advance. From the groves of banyans and bananas at Tejpur, the jeep path begins upwards through forests of oak and pine to a height of 10,000 feet. On reaching that height, the troops have to climb down to Bomdila, a 5,000 feet high plateau. The downward path is slippery and dizzy. And from there again, they have to climb up skyward to a height of 13,500 feet to the Sala Pass, full of mist. To cover 70 miles in a jeep, it has been estimated, it takes 20 hours. The slightest exertion, it is reported, makes one feel that the lung is about to burst. It is in such a terrain and under such trying circumstances that our warriors had to put up a fight, and they did it magnificently well. No wonder then that the experts on military affairs who came along with the British and American mission were much impressed and have expressed their confidence that if the Indian force is adequately armed, they could beat back the aggressor despite their numbers. The glorious heroism and martial qualities of the Indian troops who fought in the Middle East, who defended Egypt,
who liberated Abyssinia, who played a grand part in Italy, and who, side by side with their British comrades, expelled the Japanese from Burma, stand forth in brilliant light. So wrote Mr. Winston Churchill about the valor of Indian troops in his history of the Second World War. "Give us the tools," Winston Churchill declared during the last war. "Give us the tools and we will finish the job. We are now being supplied with weapons by America and Britain and a number of other friendly countries. And they, all of them, are confident that victory will be ours. Friendly countries with vast resources are offering aid spontaneously, liberally, with no strings and conditions, and with speed and fervor. Nor are we dependent entirely on imported weapons. Our factories are in full swing, and as the Prime Minister declared, piles and piles of automatic and other weapons are being produced. And on the home front, Dame Democracy has commanded all her sons and daughters to gather in a single camp for the sole purpose of annihilating aggression. China is communist and has chosen totalitarianism as its mode of political life. We have no quarrel with China on that score. We abide by the principle of coexistence. But we cannot forget that it is exactly because of this mode of political life that China has become militarist and aggressive. And communist China thinks that the democratic form of government is weak and vicious, and could be and should be annihilated. This idea has become so intense that a sort of fanaticism has got hold of them. In that sense, China has become a menace not only to India, but to all those who value and adhere to the democratic way of life and to the representative form of parliamentary government. Chinese fanaticism has become so pronounced that even countries of communist persuasion, brotherly countries, feel and express, mildly though, that China has become a menace to the socialistic ideology itself. Most of the countries are agreed that China has broken all canons of justice and international law. It is in that spirit that Mr. Philip Talbot, Assistant Secretary of State, USA, has stated, "We are not seeking a new ally. We are helping a friend whose attic has been entered by a burglar." The American ambassador, Mr. Galbraith, has gone a step further and has given expression to a noble sentiment. He has stated that his country would like India to get aid from all and any source, including Soviet Russia. While American leaders are expressing such fine and noble sentiments, we find some speak disparagingly about our getting aid from USA and UK. They say that imperialism is exploiting the situation. This is an insinuation, venomous and uncharitable. Mr. B.K. Nehru, Indian ambassador in America, has correctly portrayed the sentiments of the people here. Says Mr. Nehru, "In our dire hour of need, it is the Western democracies who have come to our aid promptly and unstintingly. The hand of friendship that they have extended to us, the concrete support that they have already given and which we confidently trust will be increased, can and will never be forgotten by a grateful Indian people. We are not only grateful, but we may add that we are not forgetful of another fact some seems to forget. 21 years ago, President Roosevelt sent the same Mr. Harriman to Russia, together with a British mission, to find out the volume and variety of military aid that Russia would like to get from America to meet the Nazi aggressors. There was then no thought or talk about the imperialist noose. India does not consider this aid as either derogatory or dangerous. India welcomes indeed such aid to build up her defenses for all eventualities. The Chinese aggression has taught us a valuable lesson. Coexistence is good, but it is better to be aware also of the fact with whom we are coexisting. Rousing receptions were arranged, civic addresses presented, and there was gala all around when Mr. Chou Enlai had his triumphal tour in New Delhi, Calcutta, Bombay and Madras. Little did we imagine that sinister designs could be lurking in the mind of such a man full of smiles and a happy twinkle. When at the Bandung conference, Mr. Kotlewala of Ceylon spoke in strong and scathing terms about and against the new colonialism of the communist powers, it was to Prime Minister Nehru that Chou Enlai turned for support and goodwill. When various powers questioned even the validity and legality of China, it was Pandit Nehru's advocacy that was eagerly sought after by Chou Enlai. Whoever thought that a day would come when Chou Enlai would be casting his covetous and greedy eyes over this land? But the land they claim is after all barren, one would be tempted to say. But let us hear what the New China News Agency has got to say about these lands. The disputed western sector of the Sino-Indian border contains luxurious pastures, minerals, mica, jade, crystals, rare birds and animals, and medicinal herbs. Snow too is valuable, says the news agency, for it argues snow when it melts is useful in a variety of ways. They have already catalogued the materials to be grabbed. But let us tell Mr. Chou Enlai, you have missed to take note of one other fact. In this vast country, there are millions and millions who are prepared to lay down their lives to safeguard the land where are enshrined the sepulchres of their forefathers, where are rocked the cradles of their children. China is bent upon swallowing up bits of our territory, register its might and create a balance of terror throughout Asia. All are convinced about that fact. Experts point out the motives behind the expansionist policy of China. Mr. Chester Bowles is of the opinion that China, being short of oil, wants to grab the oil fields in Assam. It is reported that when Chou Enlai visited Burma, a demonstrator flourished a placard on which is written, "Great Chinaman, spare our tiny land." That is the impression the Chinese have created. Field Marshal Auchinleck says that if China should establish its foothold in the Himalayas, it would constitute a danger to Burma and Pakistan too. But apart from the grabbing territories, China is bent upon a more heinous crime. As Mrs. Lakshmi Menon, Minister for External Affairs, has stated at a press conference at Colombo, the fighting between India and China is not a mere border conflict. This is a conflict between two ways of life, democracy and the expansion of communist totalitarianism and regimentation. But no, China will not be allowed to carry out its nefarious design. Let not the Chinese warmongers gloat over our initial reverses at Belong and at Bombilla. Victorious America had seen disaster at Pearl Harbor, and valorous Britain had to face at Dunkirk. Outcomes of stray battles alone do not decide a war. This country is determined to march along the path, unmindful of the perils and fully prepared to pay the price to keep the country free and the conscience unregimented. That is our cause, and it is so noble that it is bound to register victory.